accept this requirement of our innocence and make us worthy to announce your resurrection with the angels, to proclaim it with your women disciples, and to rejoice in it with your pure apostles. We raise glory to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit forever.
Spirit is alive because of righteousness.
If the spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells within you, the one who raised Christ from the dead shall give life to your mortal bodies also, through his spirit that dwells within you. Praise be to God always.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice in it and be glad. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew, who proclaimed life to the world, let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls. The Apostle Matthew writes, "But the Pharisees went out and took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. When Jesus realized this, he withdrew from that place. Many people followed him, and he cured them all. But he warned them not to make him known. This was in order to fulfill what had been spoken through Isaiah the prophet. Behold, my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved in whom I delight. I shall place my spirit upon him, and he shall proclaim justice to the Gentiles. He shall not contend or cry out, nor will anyone hear his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he shall not break, a smoldering wick he shall not quench, until he brings justice to victory, and in his name the nations shall hope." This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, for giving us his words of life. Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God.
Wisdom of the flesh is death, but the wisdom of the Spirit is life and peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Just prior to this chapter, in chapter 7 of the letter to the Romans, St. Paul lays out an experience that we all know, in which we have a higher goal that we should be doing, we know. It could be simple. I need to cut the grass on Saturday. And at the same time, the sofa in the living room has a beacon on it, calling me that you can take a nap. And between these two, it's like, well, I cut the grass last week and it hasn't rained, so it hasn't self-obeys. And St. Paul talks about this turmoil. Now, maybe as mundane as that, just simple. But we all have the experience of being at moments of our lives in which we know that we should be doing this, but it's this which is more the path of least resistance, and we tend towards that. And St. Paul talks about this turmoil within in chapter 7. And he asks, how can he be freed from this? Now this chapter 8 of the letter to the Romans is essential to this whole idea that we've looked at over these last weeks of being in Christ. What does it mean? We're baptized. But is that all there is? And numerous times I've mentioned to you that religion is not magic. For us to arrive at heaven, it requires our personal engagement, not just simply that we're baptized. And it's that issue which St. Paul speaks about in this turmoil. And so he speaks about the flesh, and he speaks about the spirit. And as we've mentioned, this letter to the Romans is about the contrast between the perfection of God and human perfection. And what St. Paul wants to point out to us, especially to those Romans at the church in the parish in Rome who are from a Jewish background, that the law of Moses is insufficient. It was meant to prepare for the coming of the Messiah. They were things which could never have accomplished holiness, which is why they were repeated in the sacrifices representing the coming of the Christ. But he also mentions to the Gentiles, those who come from a pagan background, these Christians, that that law of nature is also insufficient. And we've mentioned numerous times that the reason for the coming of our Lord into this world is not to simply make us bourgeois, faithful, polite people. You can do that with a decent education. You don't need the death of God on Calvary to pay your bills and to stop at red lights. But in order to transcend merely human nature, that requires a transformation from within. To be just good, okay, anyone can do that, like I said, with proper education. But in order to transcend and to go higher, and transcend my normal desires of just simply heading for the couch so easily, that requires something else that takes place within us. And so what St. Paul then lays out before us is God sending his Son, the death of this Son upon Calvary, and through that spirit of the resurrection which is given to us to transform us. Now in St. Gregory the Great, he dies in 604, so it's about 200 years. The distance between us and George Washington is the distance between St. Mary and St. Gregory the Great, to put it in a historical distance, spatial. And St. Gregory, when he makes his commentary on the prophet Ezekiel, he has a phrase in it in which he says, faith leads to virtue, faith leads to transformation and goodness. But virtue does not necessarily lead to faith. In the modern world, we mush it all up. And because the little old lady down the street makes brownies for the children and feeds the squirrels, she's really nice. And so when she dies, she goes to a better place. This is the kind of generic paganism in our modern world. But the notion of Christianity is that lady may be nice to those children and those squirrels, but she may not arrive in heaven, let alone whatever this better place is supposed to be. The happy hunting ground, I suppose. The transformation that takes place by death of God upon the cross is why St. Gregory says that faith will lead us to that transformation that we call virtue if we cooperate. But virtue, just simply being good, does not necessarily lead us to the faith. Which is why we all go through life knowing a lot of decent people who never seem to get it. They just kind of bob along through life, they pay their bills, they're decent, and then they die. That is not a transformed life. That is not a transfigured life. And so hence the commentary of St. Gregory. So what St. Paul is doing here is he's talking about the flesh and the spirit. He's not talking about two separate things. He's talking about the state of the human being. And when he speaks about the flesh, that we live in the flesh or we don't live in the flesh, he's not talking about being mortal. St. Paul's dictating this letter. He says, we no longer live in the flesh. So what is he talking about? And if he says, if you do not live within the Spirit, you will die. Well, everyone dies, whether we're good or bad, whether we are wonderful or idiots, we're all going to die. So obviously it's not physical death that he's talking about. It is the death of that transcendent life that human beings are meant to be given by God's grace. So when he speaks about the Spirit, we're talking about the individual, the person, the man who is transformed with the presence of the Holy Spirit within him. St. Paul will also use the term the new man, new Adam. The flesh is human nature just as it is. It's not necessarily bad. It will tend toward the path of least resistance, which is often sin, but it doesn't mean we're always sinning. It just means we usually find that the easier path to follow. So when he speaks about the flesh, he's talking about the human person as a whole, descending from Adam, but without any presence of God's divine spirit within them. That's the flesh. And he says, if we live in the flesh, our destiny is to die. Not physical death, but the death completely of the individual and the separation from the divinity. And it leads itself in the old man, St. Paul calls him, the old man in the flesh. It leads to a wisdom of the world, carnal wisdom, he will also call it, but a wisdom which is centered only upon here below. And it has all the frailty and all of the disabilities that the human individual without the Spirit of God has. Sometimes the wisdom of the world is very astute. And sometimes the wisdom of the world is completely off base. We have this now in the hysterical national conversation that we have. It isn't even a conversation, it's just national hysteria. We just all scream at each other. Because we have no commonality upon which we're talking about anymore. It's one of the reasons. But it's that disorder and that chaos which is indicative, in this instance in 21st century America, it's indicative of the wisdom of the flesh. We are not overall a religious people in America, even though we have religious sentiments. But we're certainly not Catholic as a people. And the stability of the Church of Christ and the clarity of the beacon of the light of her doctrine is not something that illuminates our path in America. And it's tragic, because generation after generation now for 200 years, we started already with the insufficiency of Protestantism, and we've just gone downhill since then. So that we arrive in a place like the state of Maine, which began solidly Protestant, to now a minority of the population that even claim any kind of religion. This is the wisdom of the world. It tends toward disorder. And it's insufficient even in its best situation. So St. Paul is contrasting these two throughout this whole chapter 8. So I encourage you to read 7 and read all of chapter 8. Because what St. Paul is explaining to us is what he means when he says to be in Christ. To find this life of transformation, which is given to us through faith and through baptism that initiates it, but which requires our collaboration. And he says that it's not mere cooperation with grace, but it is the actual victory of the resurrection of the Messiah and that Spirit of God within us, which transforms and always moves us. So that when we are open, our ears are open to that presence of the Spirit of God within us, it pushes us always to something more Christ-like. It is the example that we talked about a couple weeks ago of Saint Raphael. According to the flesh, for a woman in her 40s to ask our Lord, to ask the Lord God, to allow me to understand something of your passion, and then through that prayer to be afflicted continually with migraines, and then blindness, and then paralysis, and to spend not just simply a few hours in prayer contemplating the passion of our Lord, but to live the reality because the prayer that was clearly inspired by God for her to enter into that mystery of the passion was heard. And not for 3 hours of contemplation, but for 3 decades. According to the flesh, this is insanity. But according to the Spirit, it is glorious, and it is beautiful, and it is self-sacrificial as Christ was upon the cross. In the center of this chapter, St. Paul says that the Messiah came as a sacrifice for sin. He's making a reference to the book of Leviticus, and the Asham. The Asham was a sacrifice in which usually the victim was completely destroyed on the altar, signifying the destruction of sin. Saint Raphael, in the 19th century, chose a path of the Spirit. And so much so that the Church has honored her with canonization, recognized that wisdom of the Spirit. And even her sisters at the time, as we mentioned, when they opened the convent, she was in her 60s or 70s. She died in her early 70s, probably still in her 60s. When they go to found the new house, with all of the turmoil and difficulty that that requires, they carry Sister Rafka with them in her paralysis and in her blindness. She can do nothing physically, but they know that by the Spirit, she is a transformed woman, and she will be the source of holiness for this new foundation, whether she can sweep a floor or not. Wisdom of the flesh, disastrous. Wisdom of the Spirit, glorious. She is an example of what St. Paul is talking about here. So read this whole chapter 8, because he finishes by talking about the effects of the Spirit within us. But then we can look at it quite easily and see that what he's saying is that the Spirit within us, this divine Spirit, influences us, transforms us little by little as we work with this victory of Christ. And it produces within us divine effects, which is why he says, if the Spirit of the one who raised Christ from the dead is within you, then he shall also certainly raise you from the dead in glory. And so what we're doing is there is one resurrection. We are meant to be grafted personally into this one resurrection, and that is the presence of the Spirit. Which is why he says that the Spirit, the flesh, has concerns only for the things of this world. Whereas the Spirit has concerns for the things of God. So we can judge our lives very easily. What is my primary, what is my preoccupation in my existence? Is it the next dinner party? Is it the next hiking trip? Is it the next payment I have to make on that camp that I want? What is my primary inspiration in life? St. Paul says that the concerns of the flesh are here below. The concerns of the Spirit move us forward. Doesn't mean we can't have a camp, but the camp is quite low on the system of priorities when I am living by the Spirit. And I'm living in Christ. I begin to see everything different. That's when we begin to have an incoherence, because when we see things with the eyes of Christ, we don't see them any longer with the eyes of the flesh. And some of the things that our families or colleagues may say to us sound completely insane, because we're looking at totally different worlds. That's what St. Paul is talking about. So that it finishes with this life in Christ. So let us ask God that he give us this fidelity and appreciation of what he's trying to accomplish in our lives. Which is why the very first phrase you have in the bulletin today in the epistle is that there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. But he's talking to everyone who's baptized. Not all the baptized necessarily live in Christ, but it is the beginning of that path. So may God open our souls, open our minds fully, so that we may appreciate and enter into that victory of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Oh,
these offerings of your children and crops to you, out of their love for you and for your holy name, shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life in your imperishable kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ in his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from heaven to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saint Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Martha. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom this sacrifice is offered, for the intentions of all the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Amen.
O God, the Father, and communion and dwelling of the Holy Spirit, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let us lift up our thoughts, our minds, and our hearts.
We give them unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord with reverence and worship Him with humility. You are blessed with your only begotten Son and your living Holy Spirit. You are surrounded by the cherubim and seraphim, sing with your voices and heavenly melodies. They cry out to glorify and obey.
Thank you.
unto them.
We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we profess our faith in you, and we ask you, that in compassion of us, O Lord, have mercy on us and hear us.
Animonio, mi temor, por abajo, para el cariño, una venta la imor, por bono,
Amen.
may we, your lowly servants, be made worthy to pray with purity and holiness, and to call upon you, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Yes, O Lord, lover of all people, deliver us from the evil one and from his deceitful ways. And do not forsake us, lest temptation overcome us. For yours is the kingdom of your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
O Lord, bless your faithful people who bow before you. Deliver us from all harm and make us worthy to share these divine mysteries of purity and holiness, that through them we may be forgiven and made holy, and we raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever. Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One holy God, one holy Son, one holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth, to him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your glory, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. Our sins and for the blood, O Lord, our
And that of your only Son and of your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lord Jesus, our God and Savior, you became flesh for our sake, and by sacrificing yourself, you saved us. Deliver us from damnation, and make us the temples of your holy name, for we are your people and your inheritance. Glorify and honor you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. So I want to just take a moment. I have a note in the bulletin to thank you all for last weekend. It was very beautiful, even as we knelt in under the 100-degree heat. So I was doubly grateful to you for your generosity for coming out for it. The bishop was very happy. In fact, I just got a card yesterday thanking me for the two lovely days out here. And he says he has great hope for the parish in the future. So, again, profound gratitude for coming out and for your generosity and your cards and your gifts. It's a bit overwhelming. And of course, a year ago at this time, we were in kind of pain and agony and desolation. So the bishop was doubly happy that clearly we have our eyes set on the future at this point. And so praise be to God for all of that. And may God reward you for the generosity to his servant. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.
Thank you.